Welcome to the fourth Tartarus Devlog. In this video, I'll discuss the principles of object picking and show its challenges in three dimensions. Then, I'll demonstrate Tartarus's new picking system and highlight component. In the third Tartarus Devlog, we looked at axis-aligned and object-oriented bounding boxes and discussed their applications in things like collision detection. It turns out that some of the machinery developed for the bounding box component will serve as a key piece for the object-picking system I'll show you later in this video. For those unfamiliar with the term picking, it's exactly what it sounds like. Selecting an object, usually by clicking on it with your mouse, or if you're on mobile, tapping on your screen. The computer-based paradigm makes it a little easier to discuss picking, so I'll talk about a computer and mouse throughout the rest of the video. However, everything I say will apply to phones equally well if phrases like mouse clicks are replaced with screen taps. Perhaps without realizing it, you use object picking all the time. More than likely, you use it to open your web browser, select the YouTube search box, click on videos you want to watch, and a huge number of other tasks. You constantly use your mouse to interact with most of the features you regularly use on your computer. In fact, picking is so vital to modern computers and software that we've come to expect, if not demand, the ability to click on stuff. I mean, imagine if YouTube and our internet browsers conspired to enforce that we use our keyboards for everything. It'd be borderline torturous. Or imagine trying to play StarCraft, or if you're like me, Yuri's Revenge without a mouse. That's not to say that a mouse is required for absolutely everything. In principle, it's possible to use most of the core features of a computer without a mouse. Terminals exist for a reason, and I'll readily admit that some of my favorite pieces of software require no mouse input at all. However, for higher level software, things like graphics and video editors, presentation creators, and video games, it may be prohibitively challenging, if not infeasible, to forego a mouse. But even if it were possible, it just sounds absolutely dreadful. Think about it this way. Is anyone who currently owns a smartphone interested in going back to the days when you had to use arrows to select your text messages or contacts? I'll happily stick with my touchscreen. And so, just like in all these other applications, I want Tartarus to provide the freedom to use a computer mouse to press buttons, drag creatures around, and so forth. As you might expect, the ability to click stuff is neither magic nor a guaranteed right. Your operating system has some sort of built-in object-picking system that detects your cursor's location on the screen relative to all the other displayed entities. If your cursor overlaps with a selectable entity when you click your mouse, your operating system executes an appropriate action like open, play, or maximize, depending on the entity you've selected and the software with which it's associated. But how do we actually make that happen? Well, each selectable Tartarus entity will have something along the lines of a vertices component, and we need to use these vertices to determine whether the cursor is positioned within the confines of that entity when the mouse is clicked. Here's a simple example with a two-dimensional rectangular entity. In this case, determining whether the cursor is clicking inside the rectangle is really easy. We just need to test whether the X and Y coordinates of the cursor fall on the appropriate side of the entity's edges. If we think of the edges as facing outward from the shape's center, we say that the cursor needs to be behind all four edges. But here's a slightly more challenging situation in which the rectangle is rotated. With the sloped edges, we can no longer just compare X and Y coordinates of the cursor and entity edges. In this case, we have to take the vertices and produce a set of line equations. Then we can use those lines to determine on which side the cursor is located. It's a little tedious, but still relatively simple. However, this is the 2D case, and remember that Tartarus is intended to accommodate 3D objects as well. Just like in the 2D case, when this rectangular prism is oriented in the right way, it's easy to determine whether the cursor overlaps with the prism. We just perform the coordinate tests like before. But what do we do in the general case in which the entity is in some arbitrary orientation? Now we have this extremely complicated set of vertices, edges, and faces with no easy, generalizable solution. We can no longer use edges like before. And even if you could find some clever way to do it with a rectangular prism, the approach probably wouldn't generalize to entities with different shapes. Essentially, what we need is some way of converting these 3D points into the 2D case so that we can still use the line approach with the cursor's position. Here's a step-by-step process of what we need to do. We'll need to project these points into our viewing plane, compute the convex hull of the vertices, calculate the line for each edge of the convex hull, and then check if the cursor is behind each line. Fortunately, we can reuse the gift wrapping machinery developed for object-oriented bounding boxes in Devlog 3. We'll start with the vertices and then project them onto the viewing plane. Next, we'll use gift wrapping to get the projection's convex hull. Now, we're in a good position to apply the same method we used for 2D. There are several ways of doing this, some more efficient than others. I actually find this to be a rather fascinating topic, and in the description I've linked to a really insightful resource on two of the most prominent methods. Tartarus uses the so-called winding number algorithm to perform the tests I just described. It's a little different from the line approach, but it provides the same result in principle. So with this, we're now ready to begin picking objects, but there's actually one last thing we need to consider. Namely, how do we know whether we've successfully picked our object? Well, just like when you pick a file in a folder, there's usually some kind of highlight to indicate the file you've chosen. I've implemented a new highlight component using Tartarus's Entity Component System architecture. Currently, the component is empty, and its presence is only used to signify to the renderer that a highlight should be drawn. Eventually, this component may include something like a shape or color that'll specify exactly how the entity should be highlighted. That might be a topic for a future devlog, but for now, we'll just use each entity's object-oriented bounding box as a highlight. So, let's take a look at this new picking system using a couple objects. Here, when I click on an entity, we see the object-oriented bounding box is displayed. Just as we'd expect, if I click on another entity or anywhere outside the picked entity's bounding box, the original outline is removed. Like I just described, I'm dual-purposing the bounding box as both the convex hull and highlight for each entity. In principle, I could tweak the highlight component to do something very different. I could show the axis-aligned bounding box instead of the object-oriented bounding box, change the entity's color or size, or a variety of other procedures. The highlight component will be important for making picking intuitive and useful to the user. And just like that, Tartarus now supports direct mouse input. Aside from the Entity Component System architecture, this is my favorite addition to the engine so far. Previous versions of Tartarus did not have a picking system, even though it's extremely useful, and as we discussed earlier, quite critical to most software. It lets us interact with entities in real time using our mouse, and that's a really powerful feature. This type of interactivity will be important for implementing the applications I described in Devlog 0. Now, I can start thinking about implementing clickable buttons, draggable entities, and so forth. And that's exactly what I'll be focusing on in the not-too-distant future. Thanks for watching. Although my progress is slow, I'm determined to move forward whether I run or crawl. Hopefully, not long from now, I'll be able to start building the foundations of one or more of the simulations mentioned in Devlog 0. In the meantime, if you enjoyed this content, I'd appreciate a like and your subscription if you want to stay up to date on this Devlog series. I'm thankful for all your comments, so please continue leaving your ideas and suggestions on what features or content you'd like to see in a future Devlog video. Until next time, remember to never attribute to malice that which is adequately explained by ignorance.